One of the best animations I think I've ever seen is in 3Blue1Brown's video on his binomial distributions. And since I saw it and picked up how to use Manim, I've really been trying to figure out how the heck did he make that so nicely, so programmatically. And so this video, I've been working on it for quite a while and I've gotten to the bottom of it. So first things first, there are a couple of things that we've really got to understand before we get to the bigger picture of that code. Now, this in terms of Manim tutorial complexity is up there. This is pretty high. Let's go. We've got, first thing I want us to get an understanding of is how does he get that randomizing effect with his numbers, okay? So just a small little scene here, right? Where it's given by like a function he creates to update. So this here, this is our updater function, okay? And you can see what I'm doing with this. I've got a value and it's random. And now this is, by the way, really important. I've imported random, okay? Because we use random numbers throughout the entire process. So I've got random uniform. And so this is picking a random number between 0 and 1, a random decimal number between 0 and 1, you know, completely uniformly distributed, right? Where we're gonna say, input a number into this function and now assign that random number that's been spat out to that number. If the value is greater than 0.5, so the second additional, or in other words, 50% of the time, the number should be blue. Otherwise, it is red. And then we're adding a number to the screen, or in our case, it's a decimal number, which is a mobject, a mathematical object we're adding to our Manim screen. Throw it in there, and then update from func. And it's this updater function we've created. And what we're doing is we're saying number, randomize it. And randomize is the name of that function. So we're saying update from that function you've created. And so what this number is gonna do is, because what this function here, this randomized function is doing, is it's taking in a number, it's assigning it a value based on a random number between 0 and 1, and we're gonna do this for a runtime of 3. So now if you're running this at 60, let me get a better color here. If you're running this at 60 frames per second, then what's gonna happen is that it's gonna, every second, there's gonna be 60 different values being assigned to that number. Okay, that's what this function is doing. So now that's like really, really important to understand, because that's how the number is changing its value and everything is going to stem from there. Okay, so with that down, let's go on to it. Okay, so now we're dealing with more randomizing. So instead of just randomizing one number, we want to randomize a group of numbers or more than one. So what we do is, instead of just going for a number, we create a for loop. So for num in numbers. Now again, this again is a randomizing updater. So we're going to apply this to our group of numbers. Okay, it's gonna take in the numbers, so more than one, and so for the numbers, for num in numbers, so there's gonna be a whole list of numbers here, this lot here, let's say. So for each one, so it's gonna go through it one at a time. So for this first one here, what it's gonna do, assign it a number between 0 and 1 at uniform distribution, set the value of that, and if the value is greater than 0.2, then we're all good. Otherwise, it's not. And it's gonna go through that for the for loop and do it for this one, then this one, then this one, then this one, then this one, or however many there are in your group. So now we've applied this from one number to many numbers. And I wanna get a little bit more exciting than this, rather than just a number. I wanna see like a little tick or a cross underneath it to show that something's happening here. Okay, so now what we do here is, I've got a get results, and now I'm actually returning something from this function. So this isn't like an updater function where I'm gonna go update from func and apply. That's not what I'm doing here. I'm creating a function that's gonna give me back a mobject. Okay, now it's dependent on the numbers, which are the same numbers that can be randomized. Okay, so input some numbers, I'm gonna give you some results. And so now this is a vector group of stuff where, again, for num in numbers, so we're gonna go through that same list, let's go to the same 5 there, and then if it's less than, oh sorry, greater than 0.2, then return a green tick. Set some height and put it down from that number. So it'll put a little tick there. and then give it an underline of the same color. Okay, otherwise, if it's not that, if it's, you know, 0.13, for example, then put a cross and a little underline there. And do that for the whole list. So keep doing that for the entire for loop. Then once you've done that, return that list, and that'll give me the list of ticks and crosses with the little underlines underneath my numbers. Okay, so those are my little helper functions. Then the numbers is a vector group. It's a for loop because I want 10 of them. Decimal number, add it to the numbers group. Decimal number, add it to the numbers group. So I'm gonna have 10 decimal number objects, and then on the screen, so instead of just having them one over the other, on top and on top and on top, what we want to do is we want to put them up here and arrange them to the right. Then we add our numbers to the screen, and I'm just going to play a little loop here. So instead of just writing out, do it over and over again, I'm just going to go 4k in range of 2. So just do this animation twice, go through the process of updating the numbers. It's like randomized, to flick through the numbers, make them random and random and random, and then as soon as that lasts for that 60 frames per second, it's gonna stop on that 60th frame. And then we've got a group of results, play those. And that's gonna play my results underneath my numbers. Wait a bit, and then fade out those results. And then wait, and then do it again, and again, and again, until this number is completed, which in our case, it's only 2 times. Okay, those are our primers. Now we're gonna get to that coin stacking example where we've got, it flicks through heads and tails and we see many, many, many iterations of it. And, if it's 5 out of 10, which is our most likely outcome, then it's like, yahoo, let's put a little box around that. Okay, so similar things happening here. We've got a vector group of numbers. It's given from a for loop, and this is 4 in the range of 10, it's just cut off there. So I'm gonna have 10 numbers there, and they're gonna be decimal numbers. We're gonna randomize them. So it's going through the same process, except here I've just changed the colors here just to mix it up, okay? Again, get the results, the exact same thing, except it's based off 0.5 instead of 0.2 because it's heads or tails. Now, once all that's done, then we're gonna go through this for loop. So we wanna do this 14 times, okay? All right, I'm putting k equal to 0, okay? And then I'm gonna play the numbers, animate them and shift them down while randomizing. So they're gonna move down while they're spinning through the values of that 60 frames per second. So every single second that goes by, it'll change its value 60 times, okay? Then we've got new results, and this is within the for loop here. The new results is equal to get results based on our numbers, okay? Now, for num, in numbers, so this is within the for loop. Okay, so it's gonna do this every single time. So this is going through the loop the first time round for this first list of numbers that is currently moving down and randomizing each time, okay? If the value is greater than 0.5, that's gonna imply a heads, then add one to the value of k. Okay, now I've got this here because I wanna put a box around it if I get k equals 5, which is what we do here. So if k is equal to 5, then put a box around the score. Okay, but the score is given here because the score is an integer and we're gonna set it to the value of k and next to those results so I can determine how many heads I've got. Okay, write that score. And then if k is equal to 5, put a box around it. And then notice, so that'll do it for 1 and then it'll go through this process again. But now have a look under the for loop. What will happen is it'll complete this animation and then it'll go right back up here, but then it'll reset k equal to 0. So k is kind of like that counter each time that's going to tell me how many heads I got within that one round of the loop, and the loop goes through 14 times. So that's our little heads tail stacking animation, right? This one is a really, really, really slick animation, and I cannot tell you how annoying it was to get this to work, but we finally got it to work. So there's a couple of things that we have got as helper functions. Firstly is the histogram. All right, this is just the axis, okay? Where I don't wanna include tips. I wanna go from a 0 up to 50%, and of course this is movable, right? And range it to the from X being 0 to however many possible outcomes there are. If you're going through with 10 options, okay, then there's gonna be 11 possible outcomes, right? So really that's the only thing that we've got as a parameter going into this histogram. Again, this is a vector group of stuff. So add an axis, and then I've got to have some numbers here. This is the x-axis numbers. I've gone over this in another video before, so I'm just gonna leave that there, but essentially it's just putting a number down onto the x-axis. So I'm not inheriting, I'm not going dot add coordinates here, the one that's in the library. I'm just adding my own numbers there. Similar for the y value numbers. All right, we're going through, we're setting this value equal to 0 first, and then have the number be 0%, and then go from 10% and 20% and so on all the way up to 50%. Okay, add all that stuff to the results and return it. So that's going to be our histogram. So histogram is just our axis with our x and y numbers on there. Okay, then we've got our probability of we've got our random row. So get random row, where s is the probability of success, and we're taking in 10 trials here. Okay, the values is just going to be randomly distributed, right? Random. Then we've got numbers and symbols. So numbers are, you know, the decimal numbers, and then the symbols is a tick or a cross. Okay, and they're going to be a vector group of stuff. Now we're going to be enumerating through the values here, where we've got a decimal number and we're going to set it to the value of whatever this random number is. That's the same as just random uniform. Okay, random, it does the same thing as what I had before with random uniform. All right, and then this number, move it right times by the value of x. And then if it's a positive number, then the value of that number is smaller than s. So in our case, a positive is gonna be 20% of the time. So 20% of the time, we're gonna get a tick, otherwise we're gonna get a cross, okay? If it's positive, give me a tick, otherwise give me a cross, and then we wanna match the numbers and the colors. So if it's green, put it to be green. If it's red, put it to be a red. Okay, and then the symbol positive is gonna be equal to the number positive. That's gonna come in handy later on. And then put the symbols next to the numbers and down from them. Okay, this is gonna be what we call a row, which is our symbols and numbers. And we're gonna be counting through the positives of them by summing how many positive numbers there were in that group, put them up in the center, and that's gonna be our random row. All right, so there's a bit going on there, but that's what it is. Okay, so that'll give us our axis. That's going to give us our list of results, and then we also want to get those bars into our histogram. Now, admittedly, this is where I had the most trouble coming up with it, but we're good. We've got portions where we're going to take in some data, and it's going to be put onto a histogram. Now, the data is just an array of zeros. So NP zeros. The portions, we treat them as if they are numbers, right? So as a float. If it's equal to zero, then there's portions is equal to zero. Otherwise, the portion is not equal to the total. Now the bars is a vector group, and this is what's being put onto our histogram. So it's for x and a proportion within the enumeration of the portions that we've got. And I've just got 4 points here, which are gonna be the rectangle, which is more or less the bar, okay? Where it's gonna go from here, 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 and here. Now the height is dependent on the proportion of successes out of the total, right? Set the style of our bar, which is I want them to go to be yellow and green, and have a little bit of a see-throughness, the 80% opacity, same as the stroke color, and then that's gonna be my bars returned. Okay, so there's a lot going on there. We haven't actually added anything to the scene. Those are all just helpers. Now I'm gonna start adding stuff. So histogram is get the histogram, and there's 11 possible outcomes because I'm gonna have 10 trials, and with 10 trials, I can either get 0, 1, 2, all the way through to 10, which is equal to 11 possible outcomes. So it's important to make that distinction there. Bars, that's get bars, put them on the histogram. Okay, the data is inheriting from those 11 possible outcomes, which is why I've got 11 zeros there. And then I'm just adding a little bit of stuff to my scene here. I want to count the amount of trials that I've gone through, so I'm just going to have a little total trials there, and then the counter is going to be an integer and set the value to the sum of the data. So each time the data gets one added to it, then we're going to sum that, and that's going to be our total counter. And we're also going to have an arrow, which is going to be pointing to the success bar, which is what happens in that three blue, one brown animation. And that's given by our updata function, right? Where these two here, we're gonna explain in a moment. We've got a new row, right? Which is from our get random row, which is way up here. This is this guy here, right? Get the random row. That's gonna be our new row, right? Now the row is going to become the new row. Now remember, this is gonna happen 60 times per second for 50 frames per second, right? The count is going to be the sum of the positives that occur from that new row, okay? And then we're going to add one to the data count, all right? So if there's like three positives, then bang, there's going to be three there. Now this here comes in, I'm going to ignore it for the time being, but we're going to readdress it in just a moment, okay? Bars become get bars onto the histogram, so pretty much each iteration through this 60 frames per second, just keep updating it. Put the arrow next to the bar for whatever the success is within that 60 frames per second. And then because bar 2 is my 20% of the time, I'm going to set that to blue because I want that to be the result that sticks out, because that should be the most probable outcome, right? If 20% of the time it's a success, then we should get 2 out of 10 being the most likely outcome. So I just wanted that to stick out. Then we're going to add all of our stuff onto the scene. And the vector group of stuff that's going to be updated is the rows, the bars, and the arrow. So this is where the animation really starts. Once we've got all that code there, we've got update from function, update the group based on that updater function. And the updater function is called updates. That's why we update from func. The group based on the updater function, go for 2 seconds. So this should give us about 120 results if you're rendering at 60 frames per second. Now this is where this next part comes in. Update from func, group, and then instead of doing one result every 1 frame per second, this is saying, hey, how about doing 10 for every 1 frame per second? And this is where it's important here to say end data points added. And now admittedly, this was a nice little bit of copy and paste that just happened to work from the 3 blue 1 brown code. And so really when I'm applying this, I can add 100 for every frame per second, 1,000, I could do 200, whatever the number is. Now just keep in mind, if you're trying to render this, it's going to take ages. Because think about what you're wanting your computer to do. It's like you want it to go for 2 seconds. That's going to be right here is going to be adding 1,200 results. And if you think about what happens at each frame, it's going to continuously change at each frame and it's got to do calculations. And so this is just going to take a little while when you're rendering. So just be mindful of that. And so that's pretty much it. That's how 3 blue 1 brown made some of the animations from his binomial distribution video. This is like 230 lines of code, 260. If you look at his Python file, it's like thousands. And then the helper functions is like another 1,000. So if you were gonna, it would just take forever to read through it. And so it's a credit that he manages to create it and make it all work so well.